The world is changing as we know it. Psychedelics is part of that change. A therapeutic movement on improving people's lives for the better. What is it? How does it work? What does this all mean? This is a conversation with the founder of Psilocin and Chief Operating Officer of Psilocin Pharma, Derek Welsh, a division of Revive Therapeutics.
All right, another week has gone by, and once again, we bring psychedelics to life with Revive Therapeutics, and we're joined here with Mr. Derek Welsh. How are you, sir?
I'm well, thank you, and yourself?
Good. It's been an interesting week. It's been quiet on the capital market side as far as trading in the psychedelic space, but a lot of partnerships forming, and there's a lot of interest obviously circulating around this industry right now.
Absolutely. I'm also seeing a lot of new investors coming in, a lot of new people showing up. It's great.
Yeah. This week, I want to talk about just in the news, latest developments, stuff like that's going on. Interesting components, obviously, to this industry. And I want to start with, you know, it's been about 3 months since four dying Canadians filed applications with the federal government asking for the right to try magic mushrooms. And this was to treat psychological distress towards the end of their lives. So a lot of the stuff that they were coping with was obviously anxiety, terminal cancer. So I guess my first question is that how far do you think this is from becoming a reality for people in this condition right here in Canada?
You know, I think it's really hard for me to hear that that someone had to go through this, especially in end-of-life care. You know, when somebody is palliative and they're going through the very paces of end-of-life, that's a very difficult time for anybody to go through. And the fact that they have to ask the government for permission, it's difficult to see that happening. For any Canadian out there who wishes to seek treatment or wishes to have treatment of a psychedelic nature, they have every right to go to their physician and ask for a C56 exemption, which the doctor will put through and put forward to the government, which would allow them to consume any compound that they felt that helped their situation at that particular time. You know, and I think I would hope that the government would grant that sort of request. It would be a great thing that the government would go forward with it.
When you see organizations and institutions like the U.S. military investing as much as $27 million towards this, which is a huge endorsement, and that's obviously in the U.S. Do we see stuff like this being decriminalized, you know, in the short term, both in Canada and the U.S., in addition to obviously people treating for medical usage as well?
Absolutely. I see, you know, in Canada, we have the chiefs of police that have recently said, you know what, we are advocating for the decriminalization of all drugs, which I think is a great move. This is a sign of the times. Things are changing. We criminalized the wrong things. You know, we criminalized every drug and every compound out there because we sought fit to. And then we filled up our prisons with people who used them.
Right.
You know, and this did us no good. This only cost us more and more money. For the guy who had two bags of weed in his car, he's now doing 20 years.
Right.
You know, well, and in some states, that's a reality.
Mm-hmm. Well, we often look at the state of Colorado and the city of Denver. They seem to be ahead of the curve when it comes to, like, you know, cannabis, obviously. And now we're getting to the psychedelic space where Denver, you know, it became the first U.S. city to pass an initiative to basically decriminalize psilocybin, magic mushrooms, and other natural psychedelics. Other cities that followed were Oakland and Santa Cruz. And now you're seeing activists in Washington, D.C. collecting signatures to put decriminalization on the ballot this fall, which is encouraging, obviously, for the industry. So I guess the next thing I wanted to ask, if passed, you know, this would be the first U.S. Eastern city to adopt this. So do you think this is a sign of things to come, meaning sweeping changes when it comes to psychedelics in the U.S.?
I think it's going to be big sweeping changes. I think the opportunity to learn, the opportunity to research, when we decriminalize these compounds, it makes it that much easier for people to do research. The hoops that you have to go through right now just to research these compounds is fairly substantial. You know, there's a lot of documentation. There's a lot of receiving of goods. There's a lot of how do we get this from here to here safely. When it's decriminalized and it's a misdemeanor to have this particular compound or this substance, it's a lot easier and the framework becomes that much simpler to start doing more research. And honestly, the more people we have doing research on these compounds, the better.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, we talk about North America, but also this has started to make movement on the world stage. And I was reading this week where the Medical Psychedelics Working Group has now been launched in the UK to basically campaign for the rescheduling of psychedelic drugs for research and medical purposes of what you and I have discussed. So knowing that this is happening in North America, now you're seeing across the ocean, how vital is this type of national reform for scientists looking to do critical research in this field?
It's vital to no end. You know, the number of countries that get behind psychedelics makes the movement go that much faster. Mm-hmm. And whether it's psychedelics or whether it's all drugs for that matter, it's great to finally see other nations getting on board with it, and other nations will partner with others. We haven't seen the global cannabis trade yet because it's just not available. We have seen some shipments go here and there from Canada to the US or US to another place, but it's only for scientific purposes. The idea that there could be a recreational end of this is of great importance. The money-making opportunity within psychedelics is vast. You know, the number of compounds that are out there that are of a psychedelic nature is, you know, quite extensive.
Your experience with it, you're the founder of Psilocin Pharma, which is a division, obviously, of Revive Therapeutics now. Walk me through, you know, when I think of psychedelics and we talk about the excitement and how people are gravitating, like I said earlier, the U.S. military has invested as much as $27 million. Have you seen yourself as to how this is, like, you know, anyone personally that you know without naming names where it's actually improved their life, and how so?
I've seen a number of people where this has improved their life greatly. Some of my friends who have used
it. And what kind of way, Derek, if you don't mind me asking?
So one of my buddies, he describes it as detaching himself from his ego. He'll consume mushrooms a couple of times a week, and it's almost like he's able to detach himself from his ego and see the problems that he has and how to solve them. There's a great movie called Dosed, which is a fantastic movie to watch that's been put onto the market. You can pay for it. It costs a couple of bucks. It's a worthwhile watch because they go through in that particular movie, addiction, they address a number of different disorders. Now, granted, it's somebody's interpretation of what psychedelics are. We need to do the research. We need to actually sit there, put this through scientific testing, put it through the scientific method, establish a baseline, and then move forward with a drug product, for example. Anecdotal evidence, you know, the stuff you see on YouTube and things like that, and, you know, the celebrities bragging about it and different groups saying microdosing is the way to go. I wholeheartedly believe they're right, but now we need the research to prove that they're right. And beyond a reasonable doubt, you know, we can't have subjective information out there. And this is where cannabis really kind of went off the rails, is that the effects of cannabis were overstated and underproven.
Right.
When we look at the merits of psychedelics, it really is the first business that's starting off on a microdosed level and saying, let's do the homework, let's do the research, and really figure out, how does this reflexively affect your serotonin? How does it reflexively affect your adrenal glands? How does it reflexively affect a number of the different systems in the body and improve life or cause harm? You know, we need to know these things, and that's what research really is. But looking at the United States and putting that kind of money into psychedelics research, I think it's a sign of the times. I think people are going to be attracted to this business because the military is putting in money. You have the breakthrough status with Hopkins. And not to mention that breakthrough
Oregon,
status.
Oregon, Washington, like, you know, the UK, as we just discussed, right? But like Absolutely. You said, you can't emphasize on this enough in comparison to cannabis, is the amount of research that's taking place. So if anybody's listening, watching this right now, the biggest difference from what I'm seeing, psychedelics versus cannabis, is that we're not putting the cart before the horse. There's a ton of research that's being done where overinflated our valuations of the cannabis industry doomed it from the beginning with crazy expectations, where you don't see that right now in psychedelics.
No, you don't, because right now all we have is research. There's only two businesses, at least in my view, in psychedelics. You're either in the business of research or you're in the business of selling a product.
Yeah.
And there's only one legal nation, or there's a few legal nations where you can consume magic mushrooms or truffles. One being the Netherlands, and then you have research. And that's where Revive is at today, is the research business.
Right.
We're doing two major projects with the University of Wisconsin. And one of those major projects happens to be an addiction study.
Mm-hmm. You know, I want to leave it off with this, and I want to read this because I found this extremely fascinating. Authors of a new study on American adults' usage of LSD published this month, they say they believe that the hallucinogenic has become exponentially more popular as a result, obviously, of COVID-19. They found that LSD usage increased by 56% over 3 years. So the rise was especially pronounced in certain user groups, including people with college degrees, who saw a 70% increase in people between the age of 35 to 49. Derek, you're 39 and you're a college grad, so maybe you contributed to that. So
besides, I certainly have helped.
Yeah. Look, it's the sign of times that we're in, and this is no joke. We're in a pandemic, and I'm hearing more and more about how mental illness is becoming front and center. People are having a tough time, and I understand it. So when you break down all these numbers, what do these numbers indicate to you?
I think these numbers indicate a few things. The first thing it indicates is acceptance. I think it indicates the fact, you know, a number of facts to spell it out. One, I think people are tired of the typical medicine cabinet. I think they've gone back to the backyard. You know, I think they've gone back to the plant medicine, the fungus medicine, the stuff that we had long before we had some of the key antidepressants or key mood stabilizers and things like that. Looking at the demographic, it speaks volumes. That's also what's piqued my interest in this. The writing is definitely on the wall with regards to psychedelics. And there's only so long that we can hold back. But I think it's also attracted a lot of major pharmaceutical attention. Because now we're going, oh my, what have we stumbled upon? And what did we put in the shelves? You know, what did we put the dust on? And we put the dust on psychedelics big time. That's why decriminalization is on the forefront. And once decriminalization happens, then legalization happens.
Right.
And there's a few steps in between that. But, you know, looking at what can we do better for people? And one, doing better for people means decriminalizing compounds that are otherwise harmless. You know, psilocybin does not show the propensity for addiction that other compounds do when compared to methamphetamine, cocaine, etc. When we look at LSD, it doesn't show the propensity for addiction that other compounds do either. You don't have people showing up at the hospital because of their psilocybin addiction. I just don't see the numbers there. You know, looking at how do we do better for people, we do better by providing them better opportunities for healing. And I believe we're going to provide much better opportunities for healing with psychedelics than we are with the current toolbox that we have.
Well said. Times are a changing, aren't they?
And I think it's a good thing, man. Look at that research, though.
I know.
The writing's on the wall. It really is.